So the anti-Israel agenda inside the political war on the Jewish state brings together some of the finest minds devoted to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict to shine a light on how the institutions of greatest moral and political influence are being appropriated and turned for a destructive and illegitimate purpose. This book, for the very first time, explores the full depth and breadth of the latest phase in the war on Israel, which seeks to do through political means what war and terror could not, which is to isolate and cripple the state until it can no longer defend its interests or its people. In the 2.5 years that it took me to produce this book, the question that I fielded more than any other was why? Why, when you have a demanding full-time job and 2 infant children, why would you do this? And I suppose it's a perfectly obvious and legitimate question, but in seeking to answer it, I could think only of a man by the name of Philippe Petit. Philippe Petit crossed between the Twin Towers in New York on a high wire 400 metres above the ground. And when he completed this extraordinary feat and was promptly arrested by NYPD, bundled into a police car, and a horde of journalists gathered, each thrusting their mics into his face, wanting to know the same thing, why? Why did you do it? And he answered, why? There is no why. For Philippe Petit, it was simply something he had to do. And for me, this book was something that I had to do. As a Jew from the Soviet Union, having come from a place where our people were denied basic human rights, where we suffered institutional racism, and for the most part, we suffered in silence. Elie Wiesel called the Soviet Jews the Jews of silence. And now to live freely in the West, being free to advocate for Jewish human rights and call out injustice, how can we not do that? And this political war, this attempt to eradicate any autonomous Jewish presence from the Middle East, is an assault on basic human rights and a matter of the gravest injustice. My book does not tell a happy story, and indeed Israel is bleeding badly in many of the forums that it addresses. But, as Golda Meir said, as Jews, we don't have the luxury of being pessimists. And after all, our people have built a state that can defend itself militarily, that can assert itself on the world stage, and it is my belief that in the Jewish diaspora, Israel has its finest and most capable spokespeople, because it is composed of organisations and individuals who intimately understand the political dynamics and the culture of the countries in which we live and advocate. And for this reason, the relationship between Israel and the diaspora is absolutely key. If it were to fray, this would be calamitous. Now, the anti-Israel movement knows this, which is why they target the Jewish youth and seek to sow discord in the Jewish world by exaggerating the number of Jews that support their extremist agenda. Equally disastrous would be to begin withdrawing from those forums that have become hostile to Israel. It is difficult to remain in a place where Israel is maligned, where Jewish activists are slandered, and for this reason we hear regular calls to sever ties with this organisation or that, to withdraw from formal collaborations. We even periodically hear calls for Israel to leave the United Nations because of injustices in UNESCO or voting patterns in the General Assembly. This, in my view, would be entirely self-defeating. These institutions will retain their prestige and influence with or without us. And without us, any hope of enlarging that tiny pro-Israel voice, any prospect of presenting a dissenting opinion, immediately evaporates. In fact, the opposite needs to happen. It is vital to increase engagement at all levels, particularly with those organisations that have started to become hostile to Israel. This needs to happen at youth and grassroots, membership, formal dialogue, collaboration, financial support. If you don't like an organisation's position on Israel, join it in the largest numbers possible, build support and change it, because real change can only come from within.
Hi, welcome back to the studio. We're still here with Ron Yontof-Hutter. It's very hard to get that name right. I lose it off my lips.
I'm trying to get used to it.
And Yontof, the first word we have to talk about is Yontof, because that's your, and it means holiday or festival.
Festival, that's correct.
So the Jewish people are famous for their festivals.
Well, we basically are a people of festivals and remembering. Mm. We remember the Pesach, Passover that's coming up, Purim,
that's coming up.
Hanukkah. We're people that have remembrance as one of our central features in our culture.
And we also talk about freedom in Pesach especially, which is the next holiday coming up. Talk about freedom. But the world is still all caught up in so much political mess. It's a real mess, isn't it?
It is a mess. It's worrying. I think the world is confused. They've lost their sense of values. We've actually perverted democracy. We've become a totalitarian democracy in many, many places, or edging towards that, where we don't listen to each other anymore. We deny each others the right to speak. And I'm not talking about people that are extremists. I'm talking about people like, you know, who want to give the Israel position at university functions and things like that.
Mm.
They're chased off, they're beaten, they're assaulted. They're not, it's happened to Ambassador Oren as well, not only him. You know, the Israel ambassador to the United States, he, you know, he was chased off campuses as well and couldn't speak, and speeches cancelled and so on. What kind of democracy is that?
You've been living in Germany for a while too, because you play with the Berlin Doctors' Orchestra?
I play with the World Doctors' Orchestra.
Yes.
And we do tours around the world for charity. So we've played in so many different countries, including in the Berlin Philharmonic Hall.
Mm-hmm.
And I also play with the European Doctors' Orchestra, which is London-based.
Right.
And it's also for charity as well. So we do Switzerland and Hungary and London. And
so you get a pretty good overview of what's going on in Europe.
Absolutely. And I've actually, once when I walked back from shul on a Saturday, I walked slap bang into the Al-Quds demonstration, which is organized by Iran every year through Berlin.
Mm-hmm.
And I spoke to the people that were involved in the march, and I was quite shocked at the way they spoke. And this is an annual thing. And this is a paradox about Germany, which is something I don't understand. I find painful to understand. On the one hand, they talk about, you know, Germany's existence based on Israel's right to exist. And by the way, I've never heard of another country being told you have a right to exist. You don't say that. It's a very patronizing phrase. I don't like it one bit.
And in a situation where the whole world revolts against America, saying that Israel's embassy is in Jerusalem, should be.
Just a week ago, they found a seal by Isaiah from 2,700 years ago, from the time of King Hezekiah.
Mm-hmm.
Isaiah, one of the greatest prophets, who's also quoted in the United Nations about there shall be no war anymore, putting your spears and your swords into pruning.
Into plowshares.
And all that. Yeah. And you know, it's written in ancient Hebrew.
Right, and we're still warring.
Yep.
And exactly. I have to mention one last thing, is that you're planning to do a piece of opera. Is it opera or is it...
No, it's actually cantata. It's
cantata.
Which is a form of a... It's like an oratorio, you know, if you know the Messiah by Handel, or the Christmas oratorio by Bach. It's a cantata. And it's a piece for small orchestra, two soloists and choir.
Uh-huh.
And
it's related to William Cooper.
Yes.
And your grandfather.
Yes, who got the Iron Cross for Germany and who went to Dachau on the so-called Kristallnacht. I prefer to call it Pogrom Night, because Kristallnacht was a Nazi propaganda term. It wasn't just broken glass.
And there's a correlation you've created between William Cooper, who was in Australia.
Yes.
Meeting up with and in dialogue with your grandfather.
But they never met.
They never met. But
the music and what they sing together is about a friendship based on values, even though they will never ever meet.
Mm-hmm.
But they have a bond. And it's. I think it'll be a very beautiful piece. And I'm very honored to have Alon Trigger, the composer, doing the music.
Yes.
And a gentleman in Germany, a writer in Germany called Michael Schwelian in Hamburg, myself as well. And the conductor is Dr. David Cram, who's also a composer.
Fantastic. And, well, we'll tell our audience more about that as it gets closer.
Yes, absolutely.
It's later on in the year.
Absolutely.
And until then, it's been really fantastic
to
have you on the show.
It's a pleasure to have seen you today again.
Very spontaneous, the way that we did this. But we're going out with a little bit that I shot of you playing violin, Yerushalayim Shel Zahav.
If you like.
Ah, yes. It's only a tiny bit, but I love that. It was so wonderful just to have you playing live. You brought your violin here.
It's over a year ago.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I'm sure you've improved with age.
I try to.
Until then, we'll see you next week on the Shtick with a whole show on the Art Connected exhibition that we saw at Kedem. So that's going to be very interesting. More arts, more politics, more of everything on the Shtick. Shalom.